Hello, Old Man Kelly here. Welcome to the second part of my talk on Life of an American Fireman. In part one, I talked about how this film all came together. And now in part two, I'd like to go through the film itself and talk about each shot. You know, if anything, this film is a great glimpse into the early days of firefighting and firemen. But beyond that, it shows just how far filmmaking had come by 1903. And how far it had to go before it became the medium we all know and love today.
The film opens without any credits. I can only assume that's how it was originally shown. In the opening, we see a shot heavily influenced by George Millais. A fire chief is asleep at his desk. Is it me or does it look like the desk and the light are a drawing? Anyway, an inset shot of what he's dreaming appears to the right, a mother putting her child to bed. Was this his family he was dreaming about? We don't know, but he wakes up agitated, probably worried that people just like his own family might be in danger by fire. Shot 2 is a close-up of a New York fire alarm. This is sort of an amazing shot because close-ups weren't a normal part of filmmaking in 1902. Then we dissolve into the third shot. We see the firemen waking to the call. They spring to action and quickly dress and slide down the pole. They go from sleep to sliding down the pole in about 5 seconds. Shot 4 is at the bottom of the pole. It seems to take an unusually long time for the firemen who began sliding down the pole in the previous shot to arrive. In more modern filmmaking, this would be a lot tighter. It ends with a great shot of the firemen on their vehicles racing right towards the camera. This is a wonderful piece of history as we get to see firemen leaving the station. In shot 5, we get to see him pulling out of the station. We get to see some nice action of some early 20th century firefighting equipment. I love the way the shot was composed with the fire equipment rushing from left to right. Shot 6 is the fire equipment racing down the street. The engines, hooks and ladders, horse towers and horse carriages all seem to go on forever. This shot lasts for over 75 seconds. Notice the crowd standing on the roadside watching, almost as if they were watching a parade go by. The best guess is, this was an advertised test fire run made by the fire department that was made public. So the crowds, as well as the movie camera, had been waiting for them to go by. This might have been a little one-minute film made at an earlier time that Porter used to make the film. And because most of the films at the time were of that nature, just about a minute or so long, he probably didn't feel the need to cut it shorter. Now in shot 7, things get interesting. The fire equipment goes by again, and I can only assume this shot was staged for the film. We are obviously in a more rural area than the previous shot. That might have been done to show that it was a long way to the fire. Or maybe it was because Porter wasn't concerned with trying to match up this footage to his stock footage earlier. Now, Porter does something that he only does once in this film. Moves the camera. This is one of the first glimpses that filmmakers are finally learning just what a camera can do. See the main fireman in the center there? That's Arthur White. He actually worked for the Edison Manufacturing Company. Then we dissolve to the upstairs bedroom of the house where a woman and her baby are in trouble. This, I assume, is on some sort of a stage. In fact, if you try to match up the outside shot of the house to this room, the door the fireman comes through would have been on the outside wall. But we can't forgive Porter for this error. And here comes Arthur White again, the man from the Edison Company, here to rescue the mother and child. Now watch as the fireman rescues the trapped woman. He climbs out of the window, but remember, this is a second-story window. And Look how quickly he arrives back through the window to save the baby. One needs to ask, did he even have time to climb all the way down and all the way back up a huge ladder? Now in the last shot of the film, we go back before the woman and baby were rescued. And the scenes don't exactly match up as we see the lady open the window, something she didn't do in the previous shot. Now you can find versions of this film online where the actions from inside the house and outside the house jump back and forth in real time. In other words, it's cross-cut between the two sections. And we'll get into more of that controversy in part 3 of this next week. And remember how quickly the fireman went up and down the ladder between the mother and child's rescue? In this view, before the fireman rescues the child, we see the mother begging the fireman to save her. This couldn't have happened in the time it took for the interior view. And we end the scene with the mother and daughter saved by the fireman, the hero of this 6-minute film.
So the way I understand it from what I read, the version of the film that appeared in today's episode was the way it was shown back in 1903, without the cross-cutting. But I wonder maybe if Porter had it in mind to cross-cut when he originally shot it. I mean, that would account for the interior shots of when the baby and mother are being rescued, for not giving the fireman enough time to climb down the ladder and climb back up the ladder. He leaves with the woman and instantly appears back to save the child. If Porter was planning to cut to the outside and show the fireman climbing down the ladder, that would make more sense. Or maybe since it was in the early days of filming and these were two different sets, obviously, he just didn't think about it. I don't know. Now in part 3 of this series, we're going to talk about the film after its initial release. It disappearing where everybody thought it was a lost film. It being misinterpreted as being the first film ever to use cross-cutting and how that was proven otherwise. So I hope you come back for that. Don't forget to like and share and leave a comment and all that good stuff for this episode. I would appreciate it so much. Bye-bye.